Well, I suppose they do say it's better to burn out than fade away. Last December, when I heard that Dodge was about to call time on making the most evil-looking muscle car of the 21st century, I immediately wanted to come out to the US and drive one. Partly because I've never had the chance to, but mostly because I'm fascinated to figure out how, in our more socially conscious, environmentally aware, politically correct times, well, how did this thing not only stay on sale for so long, but keep getting more and more outrageous?
This generation of Challenger has been with us since 2008. The concept, designed by Michael Castiglione, who's now at Rivian, kind of caught Mercedes, who owned Dodge back then, napping. The Germans had no intention of letting Dodge muck about building its V8 homages, and had until that moment seemed far more content to leave Ford printing stacks of cash with the reborn Mustang, while Dodge didn't have a retro muscle car. But lucky for us, Dodge's designers decided to ignore the suits in the boardroom, take the platform from under the Chrysler 300C, which was basically a mashup of old E-Class and S-Class Mercedes offal, and twin it with their latest 5.7-litre Hemi V8. But what about the looks? When Dodge showed off the concept first in 2006, it was obvious they had a smash hit on their hands. So they set about tweaking it for production, which ramped up less than 2 years later in
Brampton, Ontario. Yep, your quintessential full-fat American muscle car is actually as Canadian as Ryan Reynolds wrestling Justin Bieber in a paddling pool filled with maple syrup. I think I've upset it.
The 425 horsepower Challenger SRT8 was just the beginning. There's been a V6, all-wheel drive, more special editions than Lamborghini and Pagani combined, and some modern muscle car Hall of Famers. And we've had adventures with the lot, actually, in the pages of Top Gear magazine. There was the Hellcat in 2014 with 707 brake horsepower. Then the 808 horsepower Demon in 2017 with its optional passenger seat and the ability to pull wheelies. Then there's the Red Eye, the Wide Body, the Superstock, the 1025 horsepower Demon 170, capable of 0 to 60 in 1.66 seconds. Every time we think, oh, we've seen the ultimate challenger, Dodge has piled on more power, more attitude, and pushed the bar for tire-wrecking mayhem into low Earth orbit.
With so many evolutions and additions over the years, I asked Dodge, how many of these things have you actually made since 2008? I mean, even last year, the car's old, interest rates are going up, fuel prices are high, there's a new Mustang on the scene. They were still shifting about 50,000. But in total, since 2008, Dodge has made 857,000 Challengers. And they don't even sell it worldwide. I mean, isn't that wild? It's based on a platform that was kind of gifted to them. It started off with kind of off-the-shelf engines. The interior must have cost about $1.25. I mean, imagine the profit this thing has pumped out over the years.
But so what if the accountants are happy? This generation of Challenger won't be remembered for its economic policy.
No, I think the reason this thing will remain immortal in the minds of the muscle car faithful is because it brought Dodge back to a party it had left behind and introduced a kind of a whole new generation to the golden age of the muscle car. And whether you grew up in the USA with that street hero heritage or not, that kind of nostalgia is incredibly powerful, especially for this one.
Some of you may already know that this isn't an ordinary Challenger. So for everyone else's benefit, I hope you like ghost stories.
Okay, so picture the scene. It's just before the summer of 69 in Detroit, Michigan. Motown's glory days are probably behind it, but a Purple Heart decorated veteran who's now working as a city police officer decides he's going to treat himself to his perfect muscle car. His name was Godfrey Qualls, and he had immaculately good taste.
He chooses a model year 1970 Dodge Challenger RT with black paintwork, a black roof, and a black interior, murdered out before it was cool. It's set off with a white stripe around the tail and SE trim with the swoopy Challenger badging and plush wooden veneer inside. Under the shake hood, he upgraded to the 426 cubic inch 7-litre Hemi V8 that was officially good for about 420 horsepower, but was actually putting out more like 475.
He went for the pistol grip manual shifter, the shorter final drive for better acceleration, and the details were pure Mopar dream team. Hood pins, stiffer suspension, bucket seats, and a locking gas cap,
which the modern one
doesn't have.
Unfortunately, Dodge managed to screw up his order. They fitted the wrong bonnet, okay, hood then, with the twin nostrils instead of the shaker hood, and applied a deeply 70s gator skin top. All of those details, minus a manual gearbox, reappear on this limited edition of 300 final Challengers, which cost just over $100,000 each. And because skinning gators isn't very 2024, don't worry, the alligator top is just a sticker.
But why even pay tribute to one random guy's Challenger? Well, you see, although by day Godfrey was a cop, at night he took his perfectly spec Challenger street racing. The story is just irresistible that late at night on Woodward Avenue in Detroit, this black Dodge piloted by a mysterious driver would show up at a red light, challenge someone to a race, and then just blow them into the middle of last week. And then quickly as he appeared, the car and its unknown driver would disappear like a phantom into the night for weeks, sometimes months at a time. And this started a feverish rumor mill about who it was and what they had under the bonnet.
In 1976, Mr. Qualls decided he'd had enough of street racing. His infamous car was parked up in his garage, its sudden disappearance only throwing petrol on the story of what had become known by then as the Black Ghost. He got on with bringing up his kids and serving in the military, and his car sat covered in junk until after his death on Christmas Eve 2016. After he passed, his son Gregory inherited the choice spec Challenger sat in the garage. It was only when he set about restoring it, asking around local repair shops for parts for a black 1970 Challenger with a gator skin top, that he discovered his old man had been one of the most infamous street racers in American history. And if that story sounds wild coming from me, well, imagine how it felt when, a few weeks after driving the new Black Ghost in California, I happened to be in Detroit. Greg Qualls still lives locally, and he invited me over to his place, to the very garage where the original Black Ghost was brought back to life.
See, I never knew anything about my dad racing. To me, it was just a car in a garage. It was just my dad's car in a garage. As a little boy, and I had my bike, like the scooter over there, and I would ride it, and then I'd bring it in the garage, and I would, you know, put it in the middle, because the way the car was set up, it was on the edge of the garage. So sometimes the bike would tip over and ding the car. So all those dings and stuff were from my bike.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's
part
of its history now. They didn't put that on the new one. They didn't put any dents in the
side. I can live without the dents. If I would have knew then what I knew now, then it would have been totally different. But, you know, it's life, right? And then I had to put two to two together, because when I was restoring the car, we noticed, like, why is this all this extra stuff on the car. You know, they were actually high performance parts. Mm. I needed to get the car running.
Yeah.
So the car wasn't originally stock. So I had to put it back stock so I can get it running and then drive it, right? Because I wanted to drive it. I wanted to understand why my dad liked that car so much. You know, why did he keep it all this time? You know, it's just an old car. Normally you just get rid of them. He sold all the other cars he had. You know, why he didn't sell this one and why he kept it in the garage covered up and boxes and stuff all over it. And when I went down that road and that journey, I understood why. Yeah. I really did. And it was a wonderful journey to understand that part of my father that I've never known.
As you can see, Greg now owns one of the 300 tribute Black Ghosts with a very cool vanity plate. He no longer owns his dad's original. So I asked him why he decided to sell the car and if he had any regrets.
So when we finally decided as a family, okay, what do we need to do with the car? Because the car, because of the insurance, you know, I had $1 million coverage insurance on the car because that's what the car was valued at. And I had appraisers look at the car because of the originality of the car. And so it was just expensive. That alone was expensive. But then you have the factors of, I want to keep this as original as possible. How do you preserve it? I need to, at some point, do a restoration or a preservation of the car, but I just didn't have that type of money. When I was looking into it, you know, the starting rates was $100,000, $150,000 just to get started. You know, and it can go up into the, you know, $300,000 because we're preserving the car. We're not just redoing it.
Yeah.
So there's a lot more things that go into that. And I didn't realize that because I'm thinking, you know, it's just a car, you know, well, like how hard is it to keep it at that level? But to really preserve the car, it's very detail oriented that I found out just through all the research that I've done and all the, you know, top people that I talked to. And then so it just came to realization, you know, what would my dad do, you know? And, you know, he sold everything else that he had. And then I think when you look at it, the things, he would want the family to do better. And for him, he was always helping the family. He was a, you know, whatever he could do to help the family. So then I really thought about that. And I was like, you know what, this could really better the Qualls family. And then so we made that decision. It was a rough decision because I really wanted to keep the car in my deep heart. But then in the reality set in, like, you know, I got to figure out, you know, is this car going to rust? You know, am I going to have engine problems? One day it might turn the key. And if I damage the engine, then I'll never forgive myself because then I've destroyed my dad's car, you know. And then to do that and to rebuild it, then it's not original anymore.
The Black Ghost made over $1 million at auction in May 2023 and has found a new home with a collector who is currently arranging to have the car meticulously restored while maintaining the originality of parts that's so precious to the Qualls family. Though it was obviously an emotional heart wrench to let the car go, Greg says the new owner isn't the type of guy to hide his cars away, so when it's finished, it will tour car shows once more, so future generations can see the machine behind the Black Ghost legend. The modern Black Ghost is based on a Hellcat Red Eye. So it's got the wide body arches, an 8-speed automatic gearbox as standard, which somehow has to make sense of a 6.2-litre supercharged V8 running 15.3 pounds of boost and developing 807 horsepower with 707 foot-pounds of torque.
All of which goes to the rear tyres, and some of it, occasionally, actually finds its way onto the road.
Dodge claims this 2-ton coupe will get from 0 to 60 in 3.7 seconds and romp all the way to 203 miles per hour. But you'll be managing the tyres every single step of the way.
I mean, the old European cliche is that, oh, muscle cars, they're only ever good at going in a straight line, but this sometimes can't even do that.
Driving the Black Ghost is a constant negotiation between the throttle and the devil. The suspension beats you up, the steering kicks back, those vast 305 section front tyres merrily tramline away, and the brakes are grabby at first, right at the top of the pedal, then squishier than the bottom of an over-rare burger when you really squeeze them. The evolution of Challenger engines has massively outpaced what could be done with its old-timer chassis, but I wouldn't have it any other way. This is exactly what I hoped the experience of driving a Challenger after all these years would be like. Raw, intimidating, brutal, but absolutely honest to where the muscle car came from. I just love its straightforward, zero bullshit simplicity.
The cliched thing to do now would be just to trot out some rubbish about how the Challenger Black Ghost, it's just always trying to kill you. But you know what, having driven it for a few days, I don't think that's true. I just think you do have to adapt and change your driving style. So I got into this thing and I was obviously intimidated by it, and I was driving it like I'd drive a European performance car, with sort of delicate, precise inputs and very swift reactions. It actually gets a lot better, a lot more trustworthy, if you remember it's a brute and it responds to a bit of brute force. So be more positive with your inputs, more direct, and dare I say it, actually turn down or even off the traction control. I mean, not if it's wet, don't go anywhere near it in the wet, but if it's a bit dry, you're better off not sat here cowering, trying to hide from the power. Just respect the car and don't sit here waiting for it to pull your head off.
The Black Ghost is so silly. A fitting encore for this generation of Challenger and its Hellcat engine, all gargling bassline and whining supercharger fury. I adored spending some time getting to know it. In its dying moments, the big bad Dodge has made a friend for life.
So we're finishing up at Alice's restaurant just off Skyline Boulevard near Highway 9 in the hills above San Francisco. Come for the breakfast burritos, stay for the roads, which, like the views around here, are just magnificent. I mean, the amount of corners, the surface changes, the cambers, it's just kind of driving utopia, as you've seen from all the people who are hanging out up here. But with the water runoff coming from the hills and the dappled sunlight dazzling you, possibly not Challenger country.
But the sunshine and the weekend has brought out hundreds of enthusiasts, and everyone from wealthy Porsche collectors to tuned M-car guys, Lotus lovers and Honda VTEC fanatics have all paid big respect to the Dodge and its story, with more than a few wearing some pained expressions, wondering how exactly can Dodge replace one of the car world's most extrovert caricatures with this electric successor?
A soul-searching question for another day. I think for now, I hope you'll join me in wishing the best, worst car in the world a very happy retirement.